Multiple columnists have left the Jewish Chronicle after the publication was accused of fabrication over the Israel-Palestine conflict. A number of prominent columnists have resigned in protest from the Jewish Chronicle after allegations it printed articles about the Gaza conflict that were based on wild fabrications. The weekly title, the world's oldest Jewish newspaper, is facing calls for an investigation after it deleted 9 articles by Elon Perry because of doubts over their accuracy and concerns he had misrepresented his CV. The sensationalist articles by the former Israel Defense Forces soldier allegedly included fabricated claims about Israeli intelligence. 4 of the paper's best-known columnists, David Baddiel, Jonathan Friedman, David Aranovich, and Hadley Freeman, announced they had resigned in protest over the scandal. Now, this is the bio of Elon Perry, a former commando soldier of the elite Golani Brigade of the Israel Defense Forces, which he served in for 28 years. He was a journalist for 25 years covering wars and terrorist attacks. Since 2010, he has been lecturing in the UK and USA about the 100 years of terror in the Middle East, with an emphasis on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. He lives in London. His website additionally claims that during his military service, he was part of a unit of Mr. Arvim, or soldiers who go undercover as Palestinians, and that he also participated in Operation Entebbe, Israel's 1976 raid of a passenger plane hijacked by Palestinian and German militants. Perry also professes to be the author of 2 books and is described by the publisher of the second, which came out in April of this year, as having been a professor at Tel Aviv University for more than 15 years. An investigation by Israel's Channel 30 news program Hazanor found no record of Perry having worked at TAU. Moreover, there was no credible evidence he'd been involved in Operation Entebbe, as his website claims. Now, the editor of the Jewish Chronicle, Jake Waller-Simons, tweeted this. Obviously, it's every newspaper's editor's worst nightmare to be deceived by a journalist. The Jewish Chronicle has cut all ties with the freelancer in question, and his work has now been removed from our website. Readers can be assured that stronger internal procedures are being implemented. I understand why some columnists have decided to step back from the paper. I am grateful for their contributions and hope that, in time, some of them will feel able to return. I take full responsibility for the mistakes that have been made, and I will take equal responsibility for the task of making sure nothing like this can happen again. Now, what I find quite funny about all of this is that the columnists who've left and the editor are acting as if the Jewish Chronicle is a reputable paper, and this is just one incident, and not the fact that it's a pro-Israel propaganda outlet. The Jewish Chronicle has lied and smeared people multiple times over the years. Press regulator Ipso last year rejected a call from 15 people who have won all libel payouts or Ipso complaints against the JC to launch a standards investigation into the title. According to the Ipso website, the title has been the subject of 13 upheld complaints since the regulator was launched a decade ago. And in response to Ipso, the JC said, "It will never be cowed by attempts to bully us into silence," as press regulator Ipso responded to a new call for a standards investigation into the newspaper. Now, it kind of reminds me of Israel playing the victim when international courts hold them to account. I mean, here a pro-Israel paper is pretending they are being bullied because Ipso have received complaints of their lies. Kevin, there's a lot there, but, you know, what do you make all of this?
Well, let's just be upfront about this. The Jewish Chronicle is not really a newspaper. It is a pro ultra Zionist Netanyahuist propaganda outlet. Mm. That's all it is. It's Russia Today, but for Israel. And just like Russia Today has faced, let's say, some censure, I think the Jewish Chronicle should face something similar, actually, because they're not actually fundamentally doing journalism. I think Jonathan Friedland, in his resignation letter that he put out there, said it really well when he said that it would become a partisan ideological instrument. But the thing is, it hadn't just become that, as you pointed out. We've noticed Ipso had held 13 complaints in 10 years. So that's more than one a year for the entire existence of Ipso. And it probably goes back a great deal further than that, actually. The Jewish Chronicle, like you say, is the longest running Jewish newspaper in the world. Although that probably wouldn't be the title it would hold if certain things in the 20th century in Europe had not happened, unfortunately. But either way, it's a well-respected, or was a well-respected newspaper. And now clearly is not that, and cannot be considered that pretty much ever again, I don't think. I certainly can't trust them on this point, because they've not tried to do journalism. This story is such an obvious example of malpractice to the point of malfeasance. Jake Wallace-Simons said that he had been deceived by the columnist, although I did hear someone say that he's less of a columnist and more of just a colonist, which is a nice pun. Jake Wallace-Simons had not been deceived in the slightest in this. He knew exactly the kinds of people he was employing and didn't think to bother checking. If someone just tells you they've been a journalist for 25 years, you shouldn't just take them as read, but that's the case. If someone tells you they've studied at a university, you shouldn't just take it as read. You should check into this. It's basic journalistic due diligence to do this. And he didn't even bother, which tells me that he wasn't interested in the veracity of any of the claims. He wasn't interested in the quality of the journalism involved. He was more than happy to print lies consistently, not just about this particular set of instances, which is very interesting that a lot of journalists in Israel are now calling Benjamin Netanyahu's bluff, that this is a direct set of leaks from his office, because every single article that this fraud put in the Jewish Chronicle directly lines up with a thing that Benjamin Netanyahu had said within 7 days of the publishing of that article. Very suspicious. But I do have to point out not just Jack Wallace-Simons' duplicity in all of this, but these journalists who are now jumping ship in the middle of this. Where was their ethic before all of this? We know damn well from investigations that the Jewish Chronicle has been at the core of the smears against the likes of Jeremy Corbyn, but not exclusively Jeremy Corbyn, of course, making up absolute nonsense to try and smear people who are just critics of the Israeli government and the IDF. That's what this is. It's a partisan political attack dog for a very specific narrow political interest of far-right ultra-nationalist Zionism. That's what this is. They were happy to publish, they were happy to continue to write for that newspaper under the current very shady ownership and the current editorial staff and guidelines. But now that it's been outed, now they're stepping back from it. Why did you grow an ethic out of somewhere? Where did that develop from? Because you didn't seem to have it before.
Well, I mean, I like the framing here that, oh, Jake, I was just stupid. You know, I messed up on this one. But it's not that, is it? Because at the end of the day, he wants to take on as many people and get as many pro-Israel voices as possible. So for him, the standard would be, I'm pro-Israel, don't do a background check, I'm a massive journalist, and I'm just going to give you loads of pro-Israel stuff. That's enough for Jake and the JC, because the JC is a propaganda machine for Israel. That's what it is. So it doesn't need to do that. And in fact, even if Jake knew about this, I don't know if he does or doesn't, but even if he knew, if this hadn't been uncovered, I doubt he would care. I seriously doubt he would care. I doubt half of them would give a shit, because the role of the JC...
I don't think they care now. I think the mealy mouth in which they've dealt with this, they've given minimal lip service to caring about this. And fundamentally, they'll go back to publishing the same rancid tripe that they did before. Jake Wallace-Simons has not changed fundamentally in the last 48 hours. He's just had to admit the obvious.
And to look at to Jake Wallace-Simons, for example, him as a person, he's an incredibly Islamophobic person. The amount of things he said since October 7th and before have been disgustingly racist. This isn't a good guy. He's a horrific person. If we look at David Baddiel has many examples of weaponizing anti-Semitism, attacking Jeremy Corbyn. Hadley Freeman, of notes, she has written some incredibly pro-Zionist, pro-Israel comments online, and I would say quite anti-Palestinian rhetoric. These aren't quality, even liberal journalists. Most of them who work there are just simply Israel's attack dog, and that's it. And some of them who work for the paper, and some of the publications within the paper, some of the articles are just pure anti-Semitism. I'm sorry, Islamophobic.
Yeah, they are Islamophobic, yeah. And it shouldn't surprise anybody that that's the case, given the fact that they are happy to employ and give columns to the likes of Melanie Phillips, rancid, absolutely, awful, awful Islamophobe. Douglas Murray has written in there as well, an open white nationalist, who, by the way, has said some very interesting things about Hitler, which, if you were so concerned with anti-Semitism, you think that would be a bit of a no-no for you as a paper. And that's fundamentally the point. You made the kind of slip up there of saying anti-Semitism. I think they are actually quite anti-Semitic.
Yeah.
I think they do betray the, not just British Jewish people, but Jewish people around the world for whom they claim, at least in part, to speak. By not giving a damn about representing their views and representing their interests, or even just giving a good face to Jewish people in this country, they care only about the service of Israeli, well, foreign policy to a degree, but also obviously domestic policy. And that betrays the Jewish people of this nation, who do need a voice, who have seen a rise in anti-Semitic attacks against them. And yet they're being betrayed by the likes of, you know, David Aaronovitch or David Baddiel or whoever, regardless of whether they've stayed with the paper or not since then. And by the way, look into some of the people who've stayed with the paper because of this. It's pretty blatant what's going on here. They are letting down all of British Jewish society. And they should be absolutely ashamed of themselves.
Yeah, I mean, I made a Freudian slip, right? But I'm actually correct, because I think when you side with fascists, right, fascists are all the same, right? They admire other fascists. And of course, many people, minority communities, obviously Jewish communities, have been the victims of fascism. So the idea that, oh, well, you know, I'm a Zionist, obviously I support Jewish people, but I'm a fascist. No, it's just anti-Semitism, isn't it? And that's why they platform the likes of people like Douglas Murray, who did say that when talking about nationalist Germany and World War II and Nazi Germany, he said, oh, Germany mucked up. But by the way, I still support nationalism. Like, you in turn, that's the thing. I've always found that Zionism is anti-Semitic. Another example is Elon Musk visiting Benjamin Netanyahu in Israel. Oh, he must love Jewish people. Oh, wait, he's allowed Nazis rampant on the website. And he himself has agreed and bolstered the most archaic anti-Semitic conspiracy theories, like the original ones. The more Zionist you go, you will find yourself in a position where you end up being anti-Semitic. Think of all the anti-Zionist Jewish people or those on the left who are called themselves anti-Semites or self-hating Jews. So the Jewish Chronicle, despite it has the word Jewish in it, Israel, many pro-Israel organizations, the BOD, JLM, all these organizations do not stand up for the Jewish community, because to stand up for a community, because no community is homogenous, many people have different ideas, you don't attack dissidents.
Yeah.
This is the pro-Israel.
Yeah. This is sort of one of the points that they essentially bolster far-right conspiracy talking points about Jewish people having a dual loyalty, that they don't necessarily believe of themselves to be British or American or any other nation. They're Jewish first and foremost, or that they're Israeli, kind of secret Israeli agents amongst us. Real old-school anti-Semitic bullshit, which isn't true. I know that for a fact. I know damn well a number of very fine Jewish people, many of whom deeply, deeply disgusted by the actions of the Israeli government, both currently in Gaza and, you know, before then. A lot of Jewish people don't consider themselves to be Israeli, because, of course, they're not. They're not all crazy, ultra-nationalist lunatics like you get from Likud and various other parties in Israel. And so to act as if they are homogenous, that the Jewish people have one opinion on anything, is a disgusting betrayal of Jewish people and their actual, you know, incredibly nuanced and layered series of opinions that they have within their communities. No, you just get from, like you say, from the groups you mentioned, and including Jewish Chronicle, one portrayal of Jewishness, which is ultra-Zionist and sort of pro-Benjamin Netanyahu, which we know from polling isn't true. British Jewish people deeply dislike Benjamin Netanyahu. Even those who are Zionists don't like Benjamin Netanyahu. And yet the newspaper claiming to represent Jewish people is very, very pro-Benjamin Netanyahu, which does make you think, You're clearly not representing the interests of British Jews, are you?
Patreon.com/turnleftmedia. Support independent media. Support social justice that's there on social media. Thank you. Turn left.